Hey guys, welcome back to Kevin Wilson SBC. In the shop today, me and Dad got a good bit done today. We did have to take the rear shocks out of the car. We had some issues with the top spring perch, so we got that resolved. Because I had the springs out of the car and because we did have the coil springs off as well, we did go back through plotting the four link again, putting the car back on the scales, and making sure we had the proper amount of preload and the left rear weight and the right rear weight like I wanted it to be. We do have a preference that we generally try to run on these cars, on these big tire cars. I generally like to have 50 to 70 pounds more on the left rear, and we usually run our anti-roll bar right at neutral, but the right rear anti-roll bar extended about a half a turn more than the left rear. And that just helps account for the chassis twist and stuff that we've talked about in other videos on how the car and the motor twist the chassis up over the right rear tire more. We also reconfirmed the pinion angle on the car. I have some video footage of that I'm gonna show you today. There's a bunch of confusion over pinion angle and how to do that. I'm gonna show you what my engine angle is. I'm gonna show you what the yoke angle is at the transmission, and then I'm going to show you the pinion angle in relationship to the engine and transmission center line as well. So I'll go over all that. I have video of that to show you. We purchased a new protractor. When you use the string method with squaring your chassis, I'm going to show you a few video clips of us using the new protractor with a pencil, like a white pencil, or you can use a round piece of chalk, and that's going to help you draw your arcs a lot better. The other day we did it with a screwdriver and some string and some welder's chalk, which worked fine, but this little protractor is a pretty cool little tool. I'll show you that and have a link of where I bought it in the description of the video. So let's jump in. Let's go over some more of the suspension stuff on the Studebaker. Dad and I are real close to getting this thing out to the track and do some testing, and of course we will video all of that. Thanks guys, let's jump into today's video. Okay guys, this is the new tool that I picked up off of Amazon. I will have the link in the description of this video. This is so much better than building a little drawing tool with string and screwdrivers, etc. I also got some colored pencils from Amazon. I will be getting some round chalk, which is going to be more durable than these colored pencils. But you can see here, I'm just making my two arcs on each side of the car, and where these arcs intersect is going to be my horizontal center line to begin measuring back from the chassis brackets and the rear end to ensure the chassis brackets are square to the center line of the car. And then of course I use this same line. I hang plumb bobs off the axle tubes as far out as I can get them, and then measure to this horizontal line that we're putting the level down and drawing right now on the garage floor. Once you have the center line of the car, which is the blue line in this video that we talked about in the video from the other day, and you can use that blue line to draw your arcs on both sides of the car and where these arcs intersect, that's your horizontal cross center line from which you will use to measure all of your other components to ensure squareness.
Okay.
Here is just a quick shot of how the line intersects through the two arcs. Here's a quick picture of the tool I just demonstrated. I will have an Amazon affiliate link in the description of this video. All that means is if you click on the link and make a purchase, I get a small credit. So what we're going to do here, since I've had the shocks out of it and had the car jacked up and made a few changes on the four link with regard to ride height. We haven't changed the bar locations, but we did change the ride height just a tad. I'm rolling the car back on the scales, of course, without me in it to begin with. Want to compare and make sure the car weighs close to the same. I have lost a couple of pounds since the last recording.
In this video, I was down to 250, and you can see here.
2614, it was 2613 the other day. 633, 645. That looks very familiar. All right, I'm gonna get in it. 2614 right now, without us touching it or anything. So don't, when you come by, don't hit it.
So at this point, I'm gonna go ahead and get in the car, and let's, the main thing here is, because of the changes, I wanna reconfirm my four corner weights, mainly on the left rear and right rear. Like I said in the previous video, I generally shoot for 50 to 70 pounds more weight on the left rear in my drag cars with big tires. So let's see where we're at. I think we're a little heavy here, and we're gonna have to make some changes.
2865. What's our rear spread?
676. 757.
That is
81. Okay, at this point, we've made some changes. We shortened the upper right four-link bar a half a flat, and we gave the right rear anti-roll bar about a heavy quarter of a turn more to extend it to bring a little more weight on the right rear. And now you can see, since Dad is under the car making these changes, I'm sitting in the car. The camera is set up recording the scales without us having to hold it. You can now see where we ended up with the left rear, right rear weight, 751 on the left rear, 680 on the right rear. That's 71 pounds. That's a tad heavier than I think the Studebaker needs, but we're gonna see how it does there.
71.
All right, we're gonna leave it right there. Did you mess with the anti-roll bar?
Yeah.
How much
did you move it? Just a tiny bit.
Like less for the turn?
Oh yeah, okay. maybe about.
Okay. All right, we're gonna leave it right there, Dad. What's our total weight?
2865.
All right.
One thing we need to check the pinion angle again. Are you happy with it?
I can double check it now. Now that we got it rolled back,
I need to see where the yoke is.
Okay, let's go over the pinion angle demonstration on the Studebaker. 0 degrees on the drive shaft. Now this is with the Studebaker sitting on level ground, race ready, full of fuel. We're going through the digital angle finder here. If you don't own a digital angle finder, check out the description of this video. You definitely want to pick one of these up off Amazon. I'm centering the angle finder on the yoke to make sure it's running center line of the car. And we can see 2.1 degrees on the pinion yoke. So that means the pinion is pointing down to the ground 2 to 2.1 degrees. Let's hear this.
All right, pinion is 2 degrees down. Drive shaft is 0. And if I look at...
Doing some fast forwarding here, sorry.
.85 on the motor. The motor is pointing down a half a degree.
I'm pretty sure this is going to create some questions. I didn't have a good place to put the angle finder on the motor or transmission like I was doing on the drive shaft. So this is a machined mandrel that bolts to the crank pulley, which is machined, all machined surfaces. So I knew I could safely go off this machine flat surface and turn the angle finder more vertically. This measurement is telling us the motor is pointing down from the front of the car to the rear of the car. It is pointing down 0.5 degree to the rear end. Had this read 90 degrees, the motor would be sitting level. no angle up or down. Had this read 90.5, the motor would be tilted up 0.5 degree going toward the rear end. I will likely be making one more pinion angle video just to make sure everyone understands this process, and then I'll be done talking about pinion angles.
So my pinion yoke is pointing down. So with the motor pointing down 0.5 degree, the pinion is pointing down 2. If the pinion rotates up 2.2 to 2.5 degrees, it's going to be, center lines are going to be parallel between the crankshaft center line and the pinion center line. Okay, you can see right here, the motor is pointing down 0.5 degree. And I usually shoot for 2 to 2.2 degrees of pinion rotation with a four link like I'm running. So we're going to be nearly perfect with where we have things set. So it's very important that you understand the engine and transmission center line with the car race ready, level ground. So you can see mine is 0.5 degree down. The drive shaft is 0. So that's 0.5 degree difference from the drive shaft to transmission yoke. And the pinion is 2.2 degrees pointed down. 2.1. Top four link angle, 12 degrees down. Bottom four link angle, 1 degree up, 1.3 degrees up. These AFCO shocks extend to 21 inches, collapse to 14 inches, and right now we have the installed height at 18 inches. So that gives us 3 inches of extension, 4 inches of compression. These are 14-inch, 150-pound springs. I personally think 150-pound spring is too heavy of a spring. We may end up dropping these springs down to 120, 125 here soon, but we're gonna go out and see how these do first.
I would like to thank Eric at AFCO for sending me over this dyno graph, because these rear shocks I have were custom made for the Studebaker. And here you can see the graph. So this is the rebound graph, our line with the valving fully open. And here's the compression valving with it fully open. So no clicks, just fully soft. And then here's the compression full tight on the shocks that I have today. And here's the rebound fully closed. This thing has some very extreme rebound valving in it. As you can see, we're approaching 1,300 pounds just before 9 inches per second of velocity. So with this kind of rebound valving, I'm pretty confident I can run the fairly aggressive four link angles I have set up for the car today. But we shall see how these shocks do. And obviously, everyone knows I have a very strong relationship with Penske. And but I, in a fair shake to AFCO, Eric has been super helpful to me. I've done a lot of customer cars with AFCO shocks and have been very successful with them. So in fairness to Eric and AFCO, I want to give these shocks a try. And I'm curious to see if I need to make any changes. you know, maybe I have App go in and work on these and see what we can do. But you guys stay tuned. We will see exactly how these shocks do on the 53 Studebaker with a blown small block Chevrolet.
Okay, guys. One of the challenges we have here is our lower four link bars really need to be a little longer. But you can see here, we have the heim joints out as far as I'm gonna take them. Now we still have good thread engagement in there on the front and rear. However, if these lower four links were a half inch longer, it would have been really, really good. Upper four link bars have great thread engagement. I'm not concerned about those at all. But I would have liked to have a little more thread engagement on these lower four link bars. Like I said, this is a 457 ring and pinion gear. Power glide with a 169 first gear. All right, we do have the airline hooked up for the air launcher. That airline comes to this switch, which is what I use to release the pressure. And then of course I have a CO2 tank inside the car. So we got our CO2 tank right here in the car. This does use the bigger 3/8 airline and Stroud. I talked to Stroud about stepping that down to a quarter, and they really recommended that we stay with the 3/8 line all the way back. These two clear lines are my breather burn down tubes from the valve covers. They go into the back. Guys, we do not put puke tanks in the front of our cars at all. All of our puke tanks go in the back behind the slicks, so that if something happens and we dump a bunch of oil in the puke tank, I'm not running through the oil. I see so many guys with vent tanks and overflow tanks up in the engine bay area, and that's just a huge no-no. I mean, especially if it's an engine crankcase, it really should be behind the wheels. It should not be where you can drive through anything that you're dumping on the track there. We did get our seat belts installed today. So we picked up some seat belts from Jegs. So these are all bolt-in seat belts with the V top. Fuel tech ready to go. And this side over here.
You can see these seat belts bolt in. I couldn't decide if I wanted to do a wraparound upper seat belts around the roll cage, but I'd have decided to go with the bolt-in V-belts for the top. And then of course we got the net over there. And I still got spare wire laying around in here. I gotta get all this stuff out and do the final cleaning on everything. Got the coil up on the firewall. Got our relay panel here on the passenger door frame.
Tell them we're 1 degree negative on camber. Just it.
You tell them what we got on camber.
Camber is 1 degree negative
on both sides. Loose,
no, right, left front is 0 to 1/4 positive.
What we got for caster?
Caster is 5 degrees.
5 degrees both sides.
And we got 0 toe right now, but we're gonna have to loosen the lower control arm and adjust the hind joint to take the camber out, get it closer to 1/4 negative.
Okay, so this tire, right, this wheel right here has got a little more negative camber than we want. So what Dad is saying, I'll get underneath here and show you guys. Let me come in on the creeper. So what we're gonna do on this lower control arm, this hind joint right here, we're going to shorten this lower control arm, bringing the lower ball joint in and getting rid of this negative camber. I'm looking for 1/4 degree negative on the right to 0 to 1/4 degree on the left. And we always run our caster even on our drag cars. What we're gonna do is we're gonna jack it up, take the weight off of it, and we're gonna screw that hind joint in. How many turns do you think, Daddy?
I'm gonna go probably 1.5 turns.
All right, so we're gonna turn that in 1.5 turns and then recheck our camber and we'll see what we got. All right, so I'm gonna turn the camera off while we do that and then let you know what we have when we're done.
Look at the bubble. You can see it's 0.
Yep.
And we're sitting on 0 camber.
0 camber. Yep.
That looks pretty zeroed out right here.
That is... bubble center.
Yep.
What are we showing on?
Looks like an 8 negative.
Yep.
What does negative. It look like to you?
1/4 negative.
1/4 negative.
So that's
good. Let me see that in better light. Okay. Ain't nothing wrong with that, Daddy. We got 0 on the left front,
1/4 negative on the right front. Now we...
Whenever I adjusted the toe of the camber in, that means the tie rod towed the wheel out.
Correct.
So once I reset my toe in, I'll be closer to 0.
Right. You want to take the toe in real quick or you want to put it back on your plates?
Now I gotta put it on plates to check that. Whenever I roll it back on plates, then I'll finish the alignment. But I got the camber where I want it. I gotta tighten up that bolt with the lower control arm.
Okay. All right, so guys, today we did finalize the four link on the rear, went over that. I did have to take the rear shocks off the car and put the front clip in, the top clip on the AFCO. They have a clip that holds the spring cup in, and we had that messed up, so I had to take the rear shocks back out and fix those clips. I'm not so sure I can get a good video of those clips from underneath, but I'll try to do that in just a second. And whenever we did that, I wanted to recheck the four link bars, remeasure everything. We did change the ride height just a tad. I'll show you the new four link plot for that here in a few minutes. We kept the bars in the same hole locations, but because of the ride height change, we did change our four link to a little bit over 100%, like 102% anti-squat, right around there. Just a little over 50 inches long and just a tad higher than we had it. I'll go over that all that in just a minute.
Bear with me here on this video, and sorry for the shaky camera, but this is important. On these AFCO shocks, there is a retaining clip up top that holds the blue spring perch in place on the shock. And when we had the car jacked up earlier in the week, I had forgot to confirm that these clips were properly in place, and they were not. So I wanted to take a minute to show you how important these clips are to holding that in.
Okay guys, what I'm trying to show you here, there are two metal clips on top of these AFCO shocks that lock in that top of that spring perch. So that very top blue thing that you're seeing locks in with those clips, and those clips were not straight. Let me see if I can get up in here. I don't know if that's going to focus or not, but you can see what I'm talking about right here. Those two clips and that clip squeezes together with those two thumb pieces, and that blue top plate snaps up or seats up in there. And I did not have those in correctly. So the best way for me to fix that was to take the shocks out. Like I said, you can see here, we have the shock installed height 18 inches from the center of the top bolt to the center of the bottom bolt. And we have both shocks set even. They're both at 18 inches installed height. And that gives us a good sweet spot. You know, on a big tire slick car, I will generally leave about a little more compression room than I do extension. You know, we're not trying to drive a lot of rear separation here on a prep track. This car will be ran on a prep track. You can also see we got the anti-roll bars connected right here. Another important thing to understand is with the anti-roll bars in the car at ride height, I have the anti-roll bars pretty level to the ground, so they have plenty of bottom travel and plenty of top travel as the suspension operates.
Let's take a look at the new four link plot with the changes we've made on the car. This is not a big change at all, but you can see the instant center length is now 51.5 inches long, 8 inches high, which comes out to be 104% anti-squat value. I do realize for a big tire slick car, this is somewhat aggressive, but with the shock valving we've already discussed, I want to see if I can do this versus having a longer instant center in front of the center of gravity, which will tend to tire shake more, But I got to be careful with this aggressive four-link setup, as it could hit the sidewalls pretty hard if I don't keep control of that. But guys, that's what all this is about. This is the baseline that I'm going to set up for the car. And here soon, we'll go out and test this at a track, and you'll get to see the real footage from how things work. So stay tuned.
Okay, guys, I hope that video made sense. Just some more stuff to help you understand how we approach our suspensions, what we did with the front end, how we set the camber and the caster. We didn't go through showing you all the gauge work, but we did show you how we've changed the camber on the front end and then how we confirmed that afterwards. Got the pinion angle set, got the four link set, all jam nuts are tight. We got the shock set, we confirmed everything, we confirmed the weights again. The weights were within a pound or two of what we had in the video that you seen the other day. So you can go check out the video I just released that shows you all the weights of the car. We're very happy with the weight of the car. With me in it, 2866, the 48 Ford with me in it was right at 3,500 pounds. So, you know, we're saving a good bit of weight on the Studebaker. The motor is the same. The converter is the same. We are running a power glide and we are running a different rear gear. We talked about all that in a previous video. But I hope you enjoyed this video and I hope it made sense. If you have any questions, leave some comments down below. And just remember, we're doing all this to do three things. We want to go fast, we want to go straight, and more importantly, we want to be safe. Good night, guys.